There we go. All right. So now we're going to talk about the Navy, Army, and the Air Force. We'll describe the organization of the U.S. Navy and the Air Force. This is a long one, but we're going to move through it quickly also. Just hang on. Here we go. All right. The committee made up of the senior officer from each branch of the armed services is the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Remember that? There it is. It is not port security. That was a wrong answer. But I didn't make this one, so. Measures taken to protect a harbor or other marine facility against crime, espionage, or sabotage is port security. Okay. A general term for lighthouses, buoys, beacons, lanterns, and radio signals. What do you think it is? Navigational aids. That's correct. All right, good. The blocking, intercepting, or preventing the passage of something is? What is it? It's exploit. That's it. Very good. Oh, I'm sorry. It's interdiction. I'm losing my brain. Exploit is one of the answers to, I think it's the next question. To employ to the greatest possible advantage is to exploit it. So you can tell I'm tired. All right. So we've already covered these. Then the first questions. Are you ready to learn today? Rainey, you ready to learn today?
No.
All right, too bad. Here we go. What part of the world does the first fleet of the Navy protect? It doesn't, because the first fleet doesn't exist anymore. So during World War II, it existed. And then what happened was, after World War II, it got swallowed up. And it got swallowed up or disestablished. So if you look over here at this picture, it says, for our nation, for us all. That is the picture of the Iwo Jima flag raising. Well, all of those Marines there were in the 5th Marine Division. The 5th Marine Division doesn't exist anymore. Okay, so they don't need it anymore. They just establish it. So there's currently only 4 Marine Divisions, and one of those is a reserve one. So, all right. So the answer is D. All right, significant that those who lead our armed forces are elected officials. So if we had somebody who was in the military and they were the one running all of our armed forces, what could that be considered? Would that be Democrat? What's the danger in that? It could turn into a dictatorship. Yeah, it could turn into a military junta. Running the country. That's dangerous. So we want to make sure that our military answers to an elected official, because the elected official is given constituted authority, because we elected them, because we are giving them the decision to send us to war if need be. So whereas military, they just go to war if they want to, right? All right, Second Fleet, or the Naval Forces Atlantic, is located in Norfolk, Virginia, and the Second Fleet is responsible for this area as well. The Commander U.S. Pacific Fleet is located in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, and the Third Fleet is located in San Diego, California. They fall under the Pacific Fleet, and the Seventh Fleet is responsible for the Western Pacific, too. As a result of renumbering following World War II, some fleet numbers are missing. Namely, the first one, maybe the 8th one too, I'm not sure. Let me explain type commands and operational commands. So when I was at HS-15, or Helicopter Anti-Submarine Squadron 15, it's now like Helicopter Sea Control Squadron or something, HSC-15. But regardless, when I was in Jacksonville, Florida, when my helicopter squadron was in Jacksonville, they were part of Helicopter Anti-Submarine Squadron Wing Atlantic. Okay. And what happened with that was HS Wing Atlantic was responsible for all of our training, all of our inspections, making sure that we were maintaining our aircraft and our medical and all that other stuff so that we were deployable and ready to go. Now, when we left to go to the ship, such as the Enterprise or the Saratoga, which I was on both. When we went to the ship, then we fell under operational control, and we were part of Carrier Air Wing 17. So when we were on the ship, we were under Carrier Air Wing 17. When we were at NAS Jacksonville, we were under HS Wing Atlantic, and HS Wing Atlantic is our type command. All right, ships categorized by functional type. Commander Naval Air Forces is responsible for aircraft carriers, aircraft squadrons, and naval air stations. Basically, all things aircraft. Commander Submarine Force, however, their cognizance is submarines. And then Commander Naval Surface Forces is all other ships, such as cruisers and destroyers and frigates and supply ships and things like that. So. All right, other operating forces, the Military Sea Command, they provide ocean transportation of equipment, fuel, supplies, and ammunition to American forces worldwide, peacetime or wartime. So if you look at these ships, it might be a little bit difficult to see. Turn off one of those lights for me, would you? Helpful, thank you. Those ships are roll-on, roll-off ships, also known as RoRos. And what you can do is they can roll tanks and Humvees and personnel carriers and all kinds of stuff. They can roll those things right onto the ship. And these things are located strategically around the world so that if they're necessary, they can get to a hotspot quickly so that they can provide material, not personnel, but material for personnel to use. Operational test and evaluation forces, they inspect and assess new systems. So if it's something new, they test it out. The Navy Reserve Forces, they're called upon to serve with the active operating forces in time of war or national emergency. The Commander Naval Reserve Forces is headquartered in New Orleans, Louisiana. The Naval Special Warfare Command provides special forces, SEALs, personnel, and equipment for fleet operations. The commander, U.S. Atlantic Fleet, is located in U.S. Atlantic Fleet. The second fleet's also located there, too. Norfolk. All right. And then the Pacific Fleet's located in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Good. All right. U.S. Navy Reserve Forces are called upon to serve with the active operating forces in times of war and during national emergencies. Should have let one of you to respond. So, all right. Primary responsibility of the shore establishment is to support the operating forces. And they fall into seven major categories, such as repair and maintenance of ships, submarines, aircraft, and related equipment. Naval communication stations to provide communications to the fleet. Recruiting and training of naval personnel. Intelligence, as in like intelligence gathering, is not like getting smart. It's gathering information about our potential enemies or our enemies. And then meteorological support, so weather, oceanography, things like that, things that will affect us operating at sea. And then storage areas and procurement of repair parts and fuel and munitions. Medical and dental health care to naval personnel. We have naval hospitals located throughout the world that provide at shore establishments to support the operating forces. And we have maintenance and operation of air bases too. So all these aircraft that are aboard aircraft carriers, when the aircraft carrier is not at sea, all those aircraft are at naval air stations getting maintained and that type of thing. So, all right, let's talk about the relationship of the Navy with the Marine Corps. Under the Secretary of Navy is the Chief of Naval Operations and the Commandant of the Marine Corps. Now, both of these guys are pretty equal. The Secretary of the Navy, though, is in charge of both of them. The Commandant of the Marine Corps is the senior military officer in the Marine Corps who directs operations of three combat divisions, three aircraft wings, and three combat surface support elements. All right, the Marine Corps is organized into two major commands. It is not Fleet Marine Force Pacific. It is Marine Operational Forces Pacific and Marine Operational Forces Atlantic. And they are located in Honolulu, Hawaii, and Norfolk, Virginia, respectively. They work collaboratively with the Navy, and the two support each other in a bunch of different ways. The Coast Guard serves under the Department of Homeland Security. Something to remember. Coast Guard serves under the Department of Homeland Security, except in wartime, they serve under the Navy Department. All right, the Coast Guard is the smallest of the armed forces. They are responsible for law enforcement of U.S. waters, port security, safety, and maintenance of navigational aids. Navigational aids are things like buoys and lighthouses and channel markers and things like that. Search and rescue at sea, interdiction of illegal drugs at sea, pollution control of ecological contamination and immigration control. They function under the Department of Transportation, the Merchant Marine, the U.S. Merchant Marine, we're changing gears here. They function under the Department of Transportation's Maritime Administration. They regulate rates and practices of ocean shipping lines, and they operate ocean-going vessels. Though they're not part of the Navy during wartime, they are responsible for carrying materiel and personnel to the hotspots. So during peacetime, the Coast Guard serves under the what? Department of Homeland Security. But in wartime, they become part of the Navy. Good. Yeah, the Coast Guard is kind of like the Navy. They do rescue people, but they, you know, it's like those other things that we mentioned too, drug interdiction and that type of thing. They are like a smaller version of the Navy. They do have admirals and captains and commanders and you know, that type of thing, and ensigns. They do have petty officers and chief petty officers and things like that. So the rank and rate structure is still very similar to the Navy. So, but it's not the Navy. And the uniforms are different. The only time you'll see like a Cracker Jack uniform, Coast Guardsmen used to wear Cracker Jack uniforms, but they don't anymore. Now they wear like the coat and tie, kind of like what I wear during area manager inspection and that type of stuff. All right, who does Commandant of the Marine Corps report to? Let's see. Y'all just answer it. Let's go ahead and answer the question with your thumbs. All right. Ha! Excellent. Very good. You're the first class who didn't choose the Secretary of the Marine Corps. Congratulations. It's the Secretary of the Navy. All right. The Army is the oldest branch of the armed services. The Second Continental Congress adopted the existing Continental Army in 1775 and formed the U.S. Army. All right. After the Constitution was ratified, the Department of War was established as part of the President's Cabinet. And then the Department of War became the Department of Defense in 1947. All right, the mission of the Army is to provide forces able to conduct prompt, sustained combat on land, as well as stability and reconstruction operations as required. They're ready to defend vital national interests at home and overseas. They are similar to the U.S. Air Force mission, though their methods vary greatly. The Air Force, however, organizes, trains, equips for offense, defense, and reconnaissance in the skies or space. Now, the mission has changed a little bit with the advent of the what? Anybody want to take a stab at it? The Space Force. So the Space Force does the organization, training, equipping for offense, defense, and reconnaissance for space. So the Air Force began as the Army Air Corps in the early 20th century, and the National Security Act of 1947 the one that changed the Department of War to the Department of Defense, also established the Air Force. They defend by controlling and exploiting air and space over hostile nations. They maintain security of vital areas of national interests, and they interdict potentially hostile aircraft. They operate U.S. military satellites. Actually, it's the Space Force operates the satellites now. And they support U.S. ground forces through bombing and air defenses. That's the Air Force. So this is how it was all broken up in June 2006. The population of the military, U.S. military. The U.S. Armed Forces answer to the will of the people through elected civilian leaders. The Constitution authorizes Congress to raise and support for the Army and to provide and maintain the Navy. Congress enacts rules and provides funding for the services, and the President is the Commander-in-Chief. So this is a little organizational chart of our military forces. Commander-in-Chief, the President, who's in charge of the Department of Defense, who's the Secretary of Defense. And under Secretary of Defense, you got the Secretary of the Navy and the Secretary of the Army and the Secretary of the Air Force, and their Chiefs of Staff underneath. The Joint Chiefs of Staff provide professional military advice to the President, the National Security Council, and the Secretary of Defense. So the mission of the Navy is to maintain, train, and equip combat-ready naval forces capable of winning wars, deterring aggression, and maintaining freedom of the seas. Our operating forces win wars, deter aggression, and maintain freedom of the seas, while our shore establishments support, maintain, and train the combat forces for the sea. Two service chiefs report to the Secretary of the Navy. They're the Chief of Naval Operations and the Commandant of the Marine Corps. The missions may differ, but the Navy, Marine Corps, Air Coast Guard, Merchant Marine, Army, and Air Force, they defend the liberties of every American. So what branch of the U.S. Armed Services is the oldest? And the answer is the Army. The image on the right, B, is correct. It's subtle, but it is correct. Because if you look at A, the Air Force Chief of Staff is under the Secretary of the Army. That would be wrong. All right, and the difference between the operating forces and the shore establishment is that operating forces take the fight to the enemy and the shore establishments support them. So, and that, shipmates, is it. Does anybody have any questions? Randy, you got any questions?
No.
All right. All right. Hey, Dulotta, thanks for joining us. Mm-hmm. We're done. You can go now.
Okay, so I got questions.
Ask some questions.
You're done recording, right?
No, I'm not, but I will.